Good evening, good morning, almost good night.
It is good morning, my time. It's 1:38 in Germany.
Amen. My brother, Pastor Neal, and myself have been given the honor of leading us in communion. And this is a bit of a challenge, because my beloved brother Harry said to me, Frank, I want you to just tell them very quickly a little bit about your testimony. Pastor Jensen, that's 1 hour right there. And then he said, and then I want you to be a little prophetic with them, because you are prophetic. Lance knows that's another 30 minutes there. And then he said, and then we should have communion. And I normally lead a prophetic communion, so that's another 45 minutes. So I'm gonna condense that all down to the 4 minute time they allocated me and do my best. And I've already wasted a minute of it. So, testimony, real fast. I must decrease that he should increase. I'm a Jewish believer, and I found the Lord performing sacrifices on a farm in Hubbard, Ohio. And I was seeking God with all my heart, had become the rabbi's best student, studied the Torah, studied the prophets, was determined that I was going to have an encounter with Adonai, even if it cost me my life. I much expected that I would probably die at the altar source, because there was no way to know if I was holy. I wasn't even sure that I was called as a Levitical priest, but I couldn't stop. And finally, after living that life, which seemed like ages and was only a few months, in the February of 1980, I performed my last Levitical sacrifice. I went to light the fire, and I made a decree. And that decree was, Lord, if you don't come now, and I always called him Adonai, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, if you don't come now, then if you are God, you must kill me, because I'm not willing to do this one more day. I can't do it. Of course, he didn't answer me. He let me make a fool of myself again, and I lit the fire. And I went out into the woods, and I walked in those very familiar areas that I grew up in. And I finally laid down in the snow, and I was determined never to get up again. I cried every tear that was left in me. My face became frozen to the ground. My eyelids were freezing. And then finally, I heard that voice. And this is what he said. For the very first time, I heard the voice of God speak to me. And he said, Son, stand up. I have a kingdom for you to serve. That word, son. You see, I'd been calling him the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I knew him as Adonai, the Lord God is one. I knew him as Elohim. So many times, the prayers. But he said, son. I stood up. I thought the heavens were going to part and something would happen. And I just stood there again. It seemed like forever. And he said this again, son, go back to your car. You see, I had just been given a Bible by a well-meaning Christian woman that I didn't trust at all. I couldn't spell proselytize, but I knew what it meant. And I went back to that book, and when I had left it, I was in Samuel. And I had just been reveling about David. And I remember saying, if I could have a heart like David, and if God would love me like David, but this was my prayer. I said it as a prayer, very liturgical. But I said, would you trust me to lead my people back to you? And I went back to that book. But somehow, mysteriously, it had changed. And it was no longer in Samuel, and it had turned to this new page that I'd never crossed that wall in. It was called Matthew. And I began to read those genealogies, and I knew them. Who begat whom, begat whom, begat whom, begat whom, begat whom. And then was Christ. Jesus, the Son of Mary. You would think that the heavens would open again, but I took that book and I threw it. And I said, who is this Jesus that is persecuted by people, that brought my relatives to the death camps, enslaved us, chased us all over the world, humiliated us, robbed us of even our religion? Who is this Jesus? And then he said, son, I am. Pastor, all I could do was drop to my knees and begin to cry. No man taught me how to repent, but I repented and I repented and I repented and I repented. I began to see how ugly and dirty and filthy my soul was. It didn't last a minute, it didn't last an hour, it was 3 days of repentance. And finally, he spoke to me again and he said, son, fill up your bathtub. I want to baptize you. I went down in that tub as dirty as could be, and I was raised again, Jesus, by the hand of God, cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Oh, I didn't know anything about tongues, but I began to speak them, and he began to hear them. I stayed in that house for 1 year with just me and the Holy Ghost.
My.
And then I realized that my people aren't just Jews. That my God doesn't just know Hebrew. And that my God isn't about color. He is color. And that my God isn't about tongues and nations. He is tongues and nations. That we're a kingdom. And yes, brother, the answer is the kingdom. It's the kingdom. So for me, brother, you're prophetic, because the thing I cherish the most about this faith God has given me is communion with Jesus Christ. I can call him HaMashiach. I can call him the Son of God. I can call him the God of Israel. I can call him the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, Jehovah Jireh, my Adonai Eloheinu, Baruch Atah. And so, we come to this place of communion.
Oh, forgive us, God.
My God, Pastor Jensen, as you said it, we tore the bandage off big.
Forgive us, Lord God.
And now what do we do? Tuesday, my brother, Lance, I'm with our brother, Daryl. We're in Chicago meeting with the gang leaders. I don't know what we're going to accomplish, but I sure learned a lot tonight. But I do know this. We cannot come to communion without first having repentance. Forgive me, brother, about this clock. But to just go through the motions of communion without repentance, you and I agreed, does not work. So my brother, I stand before you and I say to you, forgive my people for our sins against you and your people. Your God is my God and your people are my people. Your blood is my blood, and I love you with the love of Jesus.
My brother, I accept your apology. I love you. with the love of the Lord. With the love of the Lord, I love you. And may we be bound together forever. I love you, my brother. God bless you.
Could we ask you to do something along with us? I mean, your most prestigious prelates up here. Can you take a moment and also find some repentance deep inside? And how about out here? Nothing's more humbling. We don't have time to wash feet. I agree. Wellington, where you at?
He's right.
I agree, brother. But we do have a moment to find a brother, to find a sister, to look deep into their eyes, to see their soul, and ask them to forgive you as you forgive them. Can we do that for a moment? And then we're going to ask the Lord to cleanse us. Just take a moment. Trust God.
Yes. Hallelujah. You know, as I flew in here, I flew in from New Delhi. Of course, I live in Germany, and I came into the Reconciled Church meeting because the Reconciled Church is important to me, and plus my bishop is hosting it. And as a former military officer, where your commander tells you to go, you show up. But between meetings, I've talked to people, and people have been very skeptical, cynical. Like, this would never happen, it would never work. Talked to people all over the place, the world, basically. And will America ever come together? Will we ever accomplish? You know, there's some military folks that might remember this story. It was in 1927 on December 7th. A USS S-4 submarine was doing routine missions on a Sunday, actually. And as it was coming up, a surface-bound vessel hit it, and the submarine went down 100 feet. And so rescue teams set out to go to get the sub, but there's 40 guys on board. They didn't think they would get them because rescue wasn't like it is today, where we had, you know, we got real sophisticated rescue units. But the divers were persistent. Several days later, they went down, they got to the bottom where the submarine was set, and they heard a knocking. It was Morse code. True story. In the Morse code, it said, "Is there any hope?" Unfortunately, those six sailors died. But I thought about the cynicism. You know, Job says that the cut down tree can live again. Let me just skip to the good part. It says how it's going to happen. At the scent of water. Now we know Jesus is the water. This this reconciled church has more than hope. Because of the blood of Jesus Christ. Listen, I'm tired of Bible-believing Christians that doubt the power of God. We say on Sunday all things are possible, but then we say out of the other side of our mouth, we can never do this. Well, I'm here today to tell you, God is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we have asked or think, according to the power that works within us. Oh, the blood of Jesus. It will never lose its power.
Have you received your elements? Can we just ask the Lord and take a moment now, since we've met with each other, and just cleanse our spirits before Him? Would you do that quietly, please? We understand that the Lord Himself said that as often as you take of this through the Spirit, remember me and remember my body which was broken for you. I suggest that this evening we move through the eternal Spirit and possibly we see with the eyes of God, eyes of understanding, that albeit we are His body, and yes, Lord, we're broken. We're broken in so many ways, Father. My God, is it possible for you to put all the pieces together? And yet He says we are many members, one body, and let there be no schism. So, Father, we lay aside all of our rationale, all of our religion, all of our theology, all of our logic, certainly all of our experiences. And we come to you, Lord, and we simply say we believe. We believe that we are the body of Christ. And we thank you, Jesus, that you gave your body that we might become now your body. And so we do take, and in so doing, we partake of your divine nature here on earth. Knit us together, Lord, like no time ever before. Father, take away the labels from our churches. Don't let us be messianic. Don't let us be black or brown or Asian or a white church, Father. But let us again wear proudly the shield that says, one body, one God, in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let us take.
Same manner He took the cup. And our Lord and Savior said, as often as you drink of it, do so in remembrance of me. So many times we just don't take the time to remember the passion of the Christ and understanding the power of the blood. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin, the perfect Lamb of God he was. And so as often as we drink of this, let's do so in remembrance of him. Drink all of it.
Maybe after you pass the baskets, you may be seated. We're going to have an offering. And then Pastor Jensen, we're going to, you've really been a great crowd. And we're going to end with this offering and a corporate prayer. And then we're going to go home. And I believe we received a lot from this evening. You feel that way as well? Amen. So, corporate prayer, Judy Jacobs is going to sing a song. And we have a lot to think and pray about. And we've got action to take. Thank you, Pastor Jensen.